Hi, folks. Denise Howell here. And next up on This Week in Law, we have a huge treat for you. Marc J. Randazza joins me, Emory Roane, and Mike Keyes. Marc has written perhaps the best legal brief ever, much of it in Klingon. We're going to talk about whether millennials will wash cereal bowls, and we're going to see if you can sing Kiss Me in C++. This and much more next on This Week in Law.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for This Week in Law is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is TWiL, This Week in Law with Denise Howell, Emory Roane, and Mike Keyes. Episode 344, recorded May 6, 2016.
TlhIngan, Konami, Ngoq, DMCA.
This episode of This Week in Law is brought to you by TunnelBear. TunnelBear is the simple privacy app that makes it easy to browse privately and enjoy a more open internet. To learn more and get your free TunnelBear, visit trytunnelbear.com/TWiL. And by FreshBooks, the super simple cloud accounting software that's giving thousands of freelancers and small businesses the tools to save time billing and get paid faster. Try it free at freshbooks.com/TWiL. Hi, folks. I'm Denise Howell, and you're joining us for This Week in Law. I am so bloody excited this week. I can barely contain myself. We have a very special guest this week on This Week in Law, and that is attorney Marc J. Randazza. Hello, Marc.
Hi.
Marc, it's so great to see you. We were talking before the show about how you've been involved over the years in so many things that we have discussed on the show, including very infamous revenge porn cases, the Righthaven case, lots and lots of other stuff. You're universally known as a First Amendment badass, but you also dabble in other areas of the law, very near and dear to our hearts as well, including all forms of online communication, intellectual property, privacy concerns. You're a columnist for CNN. What else am I leaving out?
I was the president of my dorm in college, and we seceded from the United States.
Oh, that's huge.
Well, yeah, and we bought a Scottish lairdship, which is the lowest form of nobility, from the back of National Lampoon, so it must have been legit. And thus, the president of that dorm is also minor European nobility. So I think that was quite an accomplishment. I don't know why nobody ever wants to talk about that.
Shall I call you Sir Marc?
No, because I'm not the president anymore. So now I'm a commoner like everybody else now.
Milord, perhaps.
God. So don't start. See, then now it's going to be like Klingon and Renaissance fair speech. Oh. None of the men in this thing will ever see female genitalia again if you go on with that kind of thing.
I beg to differ. Again, as I was telling you before the show, I'm very into all this stuff. And I'm sure lots of our
You're the only one and you're married.
I don't know. You may find yourself getting unsolicited offers. I'm not going to guarantee from what gender after the show. But go ahead.
Or species, for that matter.
Or species, exactly. Yes. No guarantees of species either. My wonderful co-hosts are here as well. Emory Roane. Hello, Emory.
Hey, Denise. Hey, Marc. Hey, Mike. Glad to be here as always.
Great to see you. And Mike Keyes from the Dorsey firm. Hello, Mike.
Hello, Denise. Great to be here with you and Marc and Emory, as always.
All right. Well, we're going to get right into it. We should have asked Marc on the show years ago, and I guarantee you we will ask him on again now that we've actually lured him into our lair. But the thing that prompted me to want to get in touch currently, is Marc is the author of perhaps the greatest legal brief ever written. And it's just been filed. It's in advance of a hearing that will take place next week in the Central District of California in a case involving, I think it's Paramount Studios and CBS. Is that right, Marc?
As far as I know, it's only Paramount, but I'm not really paying attention to the main case. I'm only paying attention to my one minor issue in it. But but Paramount is definitely the plaintiff in this case, up against a a movie company that is trying to make a piece of fan fiction about, you know, a, I guess, a prequel to the entire Star Trek universe of films.
Yes, and it is called Axanar. We have a clip here called Prelude to Axanar. This is a, it wants to be, a crowd-funded fan film based in the Star Trek universe, starring Richard Hatch, among others, who folks will remember if they were Battlestar Galactica fans in the 70s, and various other things that Richard Hatch did. And it just looks wonderful. We'll let you watch a bit of it here.
The fact that the humans could lead the formation of the Federation just a few years after their war with the Romulan Empire is nothing short of extraordinary.
But it represents something very different to the Klingon Empire. Growing tired of diplomacy, their High Chancellor proclaims, if words were water, the humans would drown us all.
The bad blood between the humans and the Klingons meant that the job of preventing war and leading the peace delegations fell to Vulcan. Regrettably, we failed.
All right, so let you all watch the rest of this wonderful prelude to Axanar on your own time after the show. It does. I'm dying to see it. I hope they get it made. But there is a fly in that ointment, and that is the fact that the rights holders, Paramount here, are claiming that the entire endeavor violates various copyrights that they own. They've procedurally, they're at the very beginning of their lawsuit. A complaint was filed. A motion to dismiss that complaint had some success in saying that it was too general. So a First Amended complaint has been filed where some of the specific copyright violations were delineated in more detail. Things like the pointy ears of the Vulcan are claimed to be under copyright. Things like gold shirts and the insignia on the shirts themselves are claimed to be in copyright. Another thing that is claimed to be under Paramount's copyright is the film's, again, the film hasn't been made yet. They have a script, they're trying to get funding, and they have this wonderful trailer that they've done. So you can intuit some things about what will be in the film. And one of the things that Paramount has intuited is that they intend to use snippets of the Klingon language in the film. And here is where Marc and his client come in. Marc, tell us who your client is.
Well, they are a group of people who are into creating languages, which I did not even know was a thing until they approached me, which I found just fascinating. You know, that there is an entire society of people who are into this art. And I would say that, you know, Klingon is probably, you know, at least arguably, the granddaddy of all these creative languages. I think there's a good argument that Esperanto would be more so, but, you know, Esperanto being so old and nobody really trying to claim ownership over that. In fact, the inventor of Esperanto immediately dedicated it to the public just in case there was ever any argument. But yeah, my client is the Language Creation Society, and you can find their website at conlang, conlang.org. Just fascinating. I mean, I would say go to the website or don't go to the website if you have something to do, because I found myself just sucked into a hole hours and hours long because there's just so much fascinating stuff on it. I mean, this is I sent them actually, you know, these guys, I sent them an email this morning both thanking them and in part cursing them for how much time they had taken from me.
Right. We also have...
So Klingon is just one of the languages that they are concerned with, is what you're telling us.
Yes. I mean, there are people here, people in this organization who have created languages that have one speaker. So this is, you know, Klingon is sort of the success story of a modern conlang.
Right. You cite the Big Bang Theory at one point in your brief because there's an episode where Klingon is used, and you're demonstrating very well throughout your brief that Klingon has taken on a life of its own beyond Star Trek. It's related to Star Trek, but beyond the episodes in which it is spoken.
Yeah, I mean, look, it may have started that way, but mm-hmm. there are people who, there are friends who only communicate with each other in Klingon. You know, that's their only common language. And I don't care where it started. You know, the neat thing about this is there is no analogy at all. There's never been an analogous case. I can see Paramount's thought here that, you know, we commissioned its creation, so we own it. But I think it's just a little bit too much mission creep in copyright law, which I think is probably gone a little too far as it is. I do an awful lot of copyright enforcement, but I'd say that a lot of those cases are, I'm doing my job, not doing the Lord's work. But I'd say if I could rewrite copyright law, it would be a hell of a lot shorter and a hell of a lot thinner. And I think that this would be the first time that somebody really, I mean, I know the Tolkien estate tried to claim copyright over its Elvish languages, but this is really the first time this has ever come to a head. I'd have a real problem with that if it was successful.
So tell folks, and you very eloquently do it in the brief, and I encourage everyone to read the brief because it is just a joy to read from start to finish. It includes many phrases in Klingon that help make the point quite graphically that the language is a viable, creative, expressive form that's out there. Can I just comment too? I haven't seen any of the coverage on your brief. Marvel at the fonts that you use, both for the English text and where did you ever find a font for Klingon? I guess it just makes your point.
Someone in my staff installed it, and that was like right up until the moment we filed it. I was just raging around the office saying, can we get the damn Klingon font? We need that. I don't think we necessarily legally needed it, but it really helps prove the point. You know, I felt like if the judge is going to consider this, which is, you know, not a fait accompli, but if the judge considers this, and even if the judge doesn't, you know, I wanted to make sure that the conversation was clearly focused on the fact that this is not a gimmick. You know, this is not just somebody coming in with some bizarre notion. Although and funny enough, to put the creativity into using the Klingon language, I think it would have seemed more like a stunt without it. With it, you really do show that this is not just a matter of making the argument for argument's sake. If you control a language, no matter where that language originated, but you control a language, you control an entire mode of thought. I mean, I don't know how many of you are multilingual, but I am, and there are thoughts that I have. There are times when I have to take a thought that originally, you know, percolates out of the source code in my brain in Italian, and I have to, in my head, translate it into English, even though Italian is not my first language. There are just some thoughts that work better that way. There are some things that just don't translate. There's all those websites you can find where there are like 50 phrases that are just beautiful in some languages that have absolutely no meaning in English. Like I'm sure there's a German phrase for, you know, the joy of seeing someone else suffering while they are wearing lederhosen and eating French fries. You know, there's like a French term for, you know, feeling homesick for a place you've never been before. I don't know what it is, but in Klingon, the fun thing is it does shape the way you have to think about things. Because I was looking for, how the heck do you say intellectual property law in Klingon when there is no word for intellectual? This would be a very weak trait to have as a Klingon. So you need to look at it. And what I came up with, I was immediately, like within hours of the brief circulating, immediately scolded and berated for my awful Klingon and saying that this is not how you would say it. And the person was, I would not say unhinged about it. They were exact. I think they were absolutely right. And I looked at it and somebody else read it and said, you know, what a jerk. And I said, no, not what a jerk. That guy's awesome. This is the most fantastic thing that could possibly have happened because it's showing if you can argue about how to actually grammatically express something in a language, then that I think that proves right there that it is not something subject to possession or ownership or control.
Right. Right. You have one really good example in the brief, too. By the way, the term that Marc came up with for intellectual property law was mind property law. What was the alternative that was suggested by your irritated reader?
If you can wait just a moment, I will look that up.
All right.
It was just, it was great. You know what, I'll find it at some point, or maybe somebody in the chat room can find it.
Right.
Which I'm not in right now, so.
Okay. Yes, we'll see.
I'm way too ADD to do like this and that at the same time. You'll barely be able to restrain me as it is. I don't need to have like three conversations going on at once.
Okay, whatever we can manage. But the other really good example of how things sound very different when expressed in Klingon and grammatically in Klingon than they would in English is the translation of the Sesame Street song that you put in. Can you give us that one?
Oh, I loved that. Yeah, because it actually says like, you know, it's the day of the sun has to flee because of fear. I mean, it's just.
lyric is sunny day chasing the clouds away.
Right.
And the translation in your brief is day of the daytime star. The clouds are filled with dread and forced to flee.
Another member of my team came up with that. So Jay Woolman put that in there. So I don't know where he found it, but shout out to Jay Woolman for finding that. It was brilliant.
Right.
We also have This Week in Law translated into Klingon, courtesy of Pedelanti in the chat. I'm going to butcher this. I'm sorry, Klingonese people. But it looks like Kastavis Chut Oak. This Week in Law.
Love it. Yes, I'm not going to try and butcher it. And we've had the conversation on the show before, and I wonder if you had to go through this, Marc, when you were drafting the brief, and if you made a decision one way or the other, whether it is Klingon or Klingonese.
I say Klingon. Mm-hmm. I don't think Klingonese is sounds. First of all, it has a syllable that you don't need, so why be so wasteful? I think that'd be a very non-Klingon trait to have, you know.
Yes.
One fun thing I learned is Klingon doesn't have any word for hello or goodbye. Instead of hello, you just say, what do you want? And
love it.
And if they don't want anything, then why are you standing there? And then instead of goodbye, at the end of a conversation, when you have nothing left to say, you just leave or hang up. Which is good, because that's how most of my conversations end anyway, but just because I forget what I'm doing and I dotter off. But
it's very efficient. Mm-hmm. I think we can go with Klingon too, because where I get Klingonese from is from the Trouble with Tribbles episode, which featured Klingons that didn't yet have ridges on their heads, right? So maybe that's an antiquated usage when they call it Klingonese. Yes.
You know, that's so funny. Until I did this brief, I didn't realize that that was a thing either, that I just always remembered Klingons as always having the ridges on their head, even though I am, you know, old enough to remember the episodes when it wasn't there. They just looked like dirty people back in the day.
Yes, definitely. They needed a mustache to twirl. And I think in the Trouble with Tribbles, they might have had one. At least the truly baddie did.
Well, there's something, so of course people have to come up with these backstories to why it all has to fit. And the story was that there's, at least that I read, is that there is some kind of a virus that transmitted itself from Klingon to Klingon. So now all Klingons have this ridge in their head because it was a virus, but it's a sign of pride because there's a Klingon insult that says your grandmother or your mother has a smooth forehead.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an insult to a Klingon.
It's a bad thing. Yes.
Yes. Okay. So under Chaplinsky, you could possibly be punished for telling a Klingon that their mother has a smooth forehead, even though that would be a relatively recent development. Like your grandmother could have a smooth forehead according to the story.
Mm-hmm. So you make the point. Everybody's grandmother should, right? Because it all.
One would think, but you see, yeah. Now here we are in a complete nerd world.
We've gone down the nerd rat hole. Let's go down the legal rat hole a little bit. The crux of the brief, which, by the way, we should explain to people, we've talked about amicus briefs on the show a lot. An amicus brief is a friend of the court brief, not filed by a party to the case. So right. Mark's client is not a party here. They're just interested in the outcome and strongly believe that the Klingon language is not copyrightable.
We're just Klingsplaining.
Yes, exactly. So it's taken on this life of its own that there certainly you could do things in Klingon that are copyrightable. And you point out in your brief, Mark, that if Paramount wants to assert a copyright in various Klingon phrases used in various Star Trek episodes or movies, more power to them. But when others are using the language, that's a different story, correct?
Right. I mean, I think a phrase itself might be a little too short, but yes, mm-hmm. if Paramount wants to put out I've seen some things, man, in the past couple of weeks, like the Sai, who is in the chat room right now, I want to reach out and choke him because he keeps sending me videos of music in Klingon. And of course I can't resist, but click the damn thing. And just, you know, when you see people like in Platoon where they talk about, I seen things, man, you get the 1,000-yard stare. You will never bounce back from seeing Gangnam Style in Klingon, perhaps even the original Klingon. But
let's see if we can get people to bounce back from seeing Kiss Me in Klingon, because we have that one queued up. Victor, can you indulge me in this? Or no, I'm sorry. It's Miss Me or Kiss Me. We'll see.
I don't think we'll be able to understand anyways.
Yeah.
Ding ding. Come
I think it has to be Kiss Me because the Klingon translation is Bite Me.
What a fantastic world we live in, though. You know, isn't it? I mean, isn't it just fantastic that there are people who are this into this, that woman got not only knows Klingon well enough to do that, dressed up like that, made a video of it. My hat's off to people who have the time for that and the creativity for that.
Mine too.
So I had some actually, I had a few thoughts on this, this case, this issue. The first of all, I guess, when I was reading this, so obviously for our listeners that don't know, copyright does not protect systems or methods.
Yes.
So the real, you know, crux of this issue, when you first come upon this, a lot of people are like, oh, well, I understand Paramount's position. They have this material. Obviously, Klingon would not be around had they not created Star Trek. Right. So if you look at it, you know, Klingons, the species, those are copyrightable. The shirts themselves, the emblems on it are all copyrightable elements. But what's so interesting here is the language Klingon has now transcended the work. And it has become its own system that is not copyrightable because of all the reasons that Mr. Randazza talked about earlier. But I guess, am I hitting on that correctly?
That's the way I look at it. You know, the thing that that really came into my head when I was thinking about this is if the Coen brothers tried to claim ownership of dudism, which for mm-hmm. those of you who are not religious in the audience, dudism is a religion based upon the Big Lebowski. I happen to be a priest in the religion, so if anybody wants to marriage ceremonies, last rites, anything like that, I'm available. But you know that this came from. I mean, almost everything in it comes from the movie The Big Lebowski. But this is just something that other people have really run with. Right. Similarly, Paramount might have commissioned the creation of enough words and enough thoughts in it to make believable dialogue. But yeah, there's this theory I have is that this you can really break the chains of copyright protection if it was ever chained by it at all. So my primary argument is that this is a system or a process, right, and going way back when, you know, those have never been copyrightable. But even right, if it was, we need to have recognition that sometimes something that could be copyrighted can break free. Now, I think that's a very unusual situation. And the only two circumstances that I can think of are Klingon and dudism. So
I've got another example third of that. I do, sweet, actually, because I was ruminating on this and I was thinking that what this reminds me of, and it's not a perfect analogy, but what this reminds me of is the Google and Oracle case.
Right. So one of the pieces in our discussion points by Eric Gardner raises that very point.
Oh, I totally read that then. Yes, absolutely. But the what Eric apparently agrees with me is that, so in Google Oracle was the case where Google had modified a Java API. And the question in the case was whether or not APIs are copyrightable. And if you look at the case compared to here, it's really kind of similar where you have a language, APIs are a language for computers, a language that was created and is then transcends the system. And I guess actually the question is the API is a system. So in that instance, it should be not copyrightable. Right now, the Oracle Google case has currently the Supreme Court refused to hear, I think, Google's appeal. And so it's been pushed back down to the district court. But as it stands right now, APIs are currently copyrightable. So does not necessarily jive well with how I think it should be, and according to this case.
Yeah, see, I've got a people have asked me how we can analogize this to a computer language, and I'm a little bit less hawkish on the idea that a computer programming language wouldn't be copyrightable. Just as a philosophical theory, you know, that mm-hmm. I can see you creating something like that because it does only one thing and it does this thing in only one environment. You know, language is the basic foundation of human communication. I mean, one guy actually raised his son speaking Klingon for 3 years. And he stopped after that. Lord only knows why, but after three, you know, so there was
somebody. They were going to lock him up?
Possibly. You know, I think it's a very interesting idea. I mean, it's pretty cool. You could have native, but at some point you could have native speakers of Klingon. It is at least, this guy proved that you could.
Right.
I think the kid has no, I actually exchanged emails with the guy and, he said his son has no memory of Klingon at this point because, you know, he stopped speaking it so long ago. Nevertheless, you know, look, there have been multiple couples who have exchanged their language vows, marriage vows in Klingon.
Right.
So at some point, one of these couples is going to say, let's raise, little in Klingon, right? And we'll only speak Klingon to him and see what happens. It could happen, right? I mean, where does any language really come from? You know, the thought that it's invented, I don't think really changes that. This is a system for the basic building blocks of what it is to be human. That is to communicate with one another, to be able to give your thoughts to another person without actually, you know, having them eat your brain.
Absolutely. Chumley
and
IRC
doesn't work either, so don't.
I don't know. Maybe in Klingon it might be more acceptable.
You never know.
Chumley in IRC says he's willing to bet someone can speak C++ along the point of whether computer languages are analogous. And also points out leet speak as an example, which is an interesting thing to consider. I think that I don't know anybody who speaks leet speak. You couldn't really, because for it to work, it's visual, right? You have to see the back threes.
Yeah, and there's probably not enough vocabulary. I mean, I know that in you know, in high school, we tried to speak as much NADSAT as possible because, you know, we're all so thrilled with A Clockwork Orange. But even that doesn't have enough vocabulary in it that you could express everything. But, you know, imagine a bunch of, you know, punk rock kids with a having just read A Clockwork Orange and 1984, mixing up NADSAT and Newspeak. You know, that was kind of fun.
Mike, do you have any questions for Marc here?
Well, Marc, I did read the brief. I thought it was a terrific read. I am curious as to whether there's been any response by Paramount. Do you anticipate one? And also, will you have an opportunity to argue your client's cause before the court?
Well, they did oppose our filing of the brief, saying that it was irrelevant and poorly timed. And poorly timed, point given. Irrelevant? I think not. You know, they said that they're not actually claiming a copyright in the language, although their complaint says that they are. So, you know, you got to make your pleadings consistent with each other and to the best of your ability. I mean, it happens to the best of us. So, but they are. Will I be able to argue this? I don't know, because I know that the hearing was scheduled for Monday, but the court took it off calendar and they're just going to do this, as they say, in chambers. So this will be just on the papers. There will be no hearing. Anybody who is showing up at the courthouse in, you know, in full Klingon battle garb, go back to your homes. There was nothing to see there. I was planning to go. I had a plane ticket to go. I was going to go and just see if the court wanted to hear from me. And I was just dreading the thought that the judge was going to ask me to speak in Klingon. And then I would be called out for the Klingon fraud that I am, because I am not fluent in Klingon. But, you know, at this point, I don't think so. But remember, this case is a long time going on. It has a lot of life left in it. I'm thinking that this will probably be revisited at summary judgment. And at that point, who knows, maybe the judge will want to hear from us. But I think now, you know, at this point, with the brief filed, Axanar's lawyers, the defense counsel, now has all of our arguments. And as far as I'm concerned, they can steal them and use them for their own, and thus maybe even make our involvement irrelevant. You know, I'd love to be able to argue it, but I'm more interested in seeing the actual cause vindicated, and that is that copyright just needs to be does not need to be expanded this far that it could control a process or a language.
And of course, the other side of this issue is the whole idea that this is the idea that a fan fiction work is fair use. You know, that's, we're talking about the specific Klingon language element of this. Right. But I guess, you know, since we are all pretty experienced with fair use, I'd be interested in hearing Mike or Denise or Mark's takes on whether you think that this Axanar prequel would be a fair use in the end. You know, I know for our listeners, the fair use four-factor analysis requires something to be transformative. And the other case, the other factor that they really, that courts really weigh heavily is the market effect. So specifically with multiple films coming out right now, another reboot series of Star Trek hitting, I think, CBS coming out in a year or so. You know, I think it's pretty clear that there is, Paramount has a rather strong argument that there would be a market effect, or at least an economic, you know, economic effect, because they're still selling their own works. And whether or not it's transformative, I also don't know if it would be very transformative, since it's taking the original body of the work and just building on it. So I guess with those questions, I'd love to hear what our more experienced guests have to say on those.
Well, you know, there's a difference between, you know, what the law is and what I think it ought to be.
Oh, absolutely.
Personally, I would say this should be fair use.
Yes.
Because you're not taking anything that the other party actually – you're not actually taking their original work. You might be inspired by it, but the story, all of the scenes, these are all filmed independently. Now,
well, except some of that is original work, right? I mean, you're talking about like the Star Trek insignia, you know?
Right.
That, like the Federation insignia, that is a creative work that's copyrightable.
Agreed. But I don't think, you know, how could you make a, you know, a tribute fan film without that?
Oh, I'm right there with you. Yeah.
To me, it
seems,
Yeah, but of course we have to recognize that, you know, as attorneys, what we want the law to be and what the law is isn't always the same thing. And I think that, you know, there's a case that always troubled me, and it's the I'm sure you're familiar with it. And if you're not, we can go over it. But the Castle Rock case, where somebody wrote the Seinfeld aptitude test, and it was a trivia book about Seinfeld. And Castle Rock Productions prevailed in saying that this was an infringement upon their copyright, even though I think it's a completely independent piece of work. But, you know, now Justice Sotomayor took the position that Castle Rock itself might have made one of these, you know, almost importing the natural zone of expansion theory from trademark law into copyright law. Mm. And, you know, that always chafed me a little bit. So,
right. And I guess there's kind of the opportunity for that here, right? With the linguist that Paramount hired to create lines of dialogue in Klingon, a judge could get a hold of that and decide, yeah, that linguist could have created a whole vibrant language, just didn't.
I don't think for Klingon it would go that far, but I'm talking about the film itself. I mean, I want to see the film made. I hadn't actually seen the trailer until now. I'm dying to see it now. This is like Star Trek was a big part of my youth. That and the New England Patriots were the two things that me and my dad got along about when we were, when we were kids. It was like the basis of our relationship was Star Trek movies and watching the Patriots lose. So for those of you who are younger, they used to lose a lot.
That's a strong foundation right there.
It is. You know, it's why I have such a deep and loving relationship with my dad now. And when you can get through the bad years of the Patriots, you can get through the 2-14 year of the Patriots with your dad by your side, you're tight forever. Love you, Dad.
You raise an interesting estoppel argument about the professor, the linguist.
He said he didn't actually create it because he captured a Klingon.
Right. So yes. Now you say he's estoppel for people who aren't lawyers is you're not allowed to contradict yourself in material ways. So right. what what you're claiming he should not be able to say now that he invented the language, or Paramount should not be able to assert that on his behalf because of the captured Klingon trope.
But Paramount actually says that there are no Klingons in their pleading as part of their reason why Klingon is copyrightable, because there are no actual Klingons to talk to. Right. So that actually is a factual issue that cannot be decided at the motion to dismiss stage. But, you know, if it goes forward, we're going to try to find that poor captured Klingon. I can't imagine where they're hiding him, maybe at Guantanamo Bay or some black ops site in Estonia.
Right.
We're going to get to the bottom of that. I promise
yes.
you.
I forget if this was in your brief or in some of the coverage of your brief that I read, but there was an episode where the Welsh government was asked about UFOs.
Alien. Yes, and they responded in Klingon.
They responded in Klingon. That's just the most brilliant thing I've ever heard.
Those All right, Welsh.
Yes. The one other thing, just to toss out there for you, if you ever do get to the summary judgment stage, another case just from left field that occurred to me as I was reading through your brief and your arguments that seems unrelated to this, but might be useful at some point, that popped into my mind is the old Ticketmaster versus tickets.com case, which had to do with deep linking. And I remember it well because it was one of the first cases I really got interested in as a technology lawyer, because it did what this case does. You know, it sort of smacks you around and makes you think that you shouldn't be able to keep people from using a language. You shouldn't be able to keep people from deep linking. And the point that's relevant, I think, is the reasoning in the case that talks about factual and function features not being copyrightable, and you've got the same issue with the language that they did with the reasoning that went on in that case. It is a little bit far afield, but you might just want to take a look at it and see if there's anything in there you can use.
All right.
Anybody else have anything to say in Klingon or otherwise before we move on? Mike?
Nothing further from my perspective.
All right, Emory?
Just that Marc actually has a really great article up that is in our show notes about the Lens v. Universal, a call for reform section 512F of the DMCA and to strengthen fair use. And this is not exactly related to the Axonar case in particular, but just fair use in general that I definitely recommend everyone check out.
Oh, yeah. No, I definitely want to talk about that.
Oh,
Let's talk about it next.
That's good. That wasn't true.
That was fun, because, yeah, Marc just published this law review article on May 1st. And we've talked a lot about Lens versus Universal on the show. Mike, you've written about it in the TMCA blog, the fact that the decision got revised and got perhaps more confusing and even more difficult to apply. But this is, and it's appropriate that we talk about it. Victor in the studio was asking me when we recorded the show the day after Prince's death, if we were going to talk about Prince's death on the show. And I'm like, well, no, I really can't figure out a way to discuss Prince's death on our show because I can't really find a tech law angle to it. And lo and behold, Lens versus Universal is it, because that is where the dancing baby was dancing to Let's Go Crazy in the video taken by mom, and led to a long, convoluted legal process and a Ninth Circuit decision that kind of muddied the waters on fair use, as you point out in your law review article. Can you give us your take on the case and your solution to the fair use problem in a nutshell?
This is another one of those situations where I'm talking more about what the law ought to be than what the law is. But, you know, fair use is so important, and we have because it is, you know, copyright is not supposed to be there only to provide a way for these companies that aggregate rights to make money. You know, copyright is supposed to be there as a bargain that we strike with creators that you're not going to write a book unless you make money on it. At least that's the theory of our, you know, essentially our incentive theory that from which we derive our copyright law. So we're going to let you have a monopoly on your work for a certain amount of time. And at one time, that was a relatively reasonably short period of time with a renewal period. Now it's gone up to life plus 70 years. And, you know, and the justification for that has been that, we need to properly incentivize and reward people. And, you know, I'm sure that's nobody sitting around is thinking, I would write a screenplay, but it'll only make money for my heirs for 50 years after I'm dead. So you know what? I'm just going to go and listen to Snoop Dogg and do bong hits instead. I mean, that just has never happened. And so lengthening the period of time is one thing, but also the part of the bargain we make is that it will create more works for this robust public domain. And when you make new works, there are very few of us who have an original thought. All right. You know, unless you're on LSD, you're not coming up with very many original thoughts. You are building upon a backdrop of culture and history and other things that you've read and paying homage. And, you know, and one thing I learned in a film class from a very strange professor, but it's always stuck with me, is that, you know, the best films are about the history of film. And we would watch these Italian movies that had scenes that were obvious ripoffs from earlier Italian neorealist movies, which were even earlier ripoffs from other things. And then building on the storylines from ancient Rome. Like, that's all fair use. So when we get to the issue of fair use, that should be a right. And it was originally established as a right. Then it was looked at as an affirmative defense. And I think Lens, one of the nice things about Lens is it seems to harken back to this, it being a right. But what good of a right is it? You know, when I get a call from a potential client that says, isn't my use here fair use? And I say, sure it is. So, you know, before I'm going to put my name on in a federal lawsuit, you're going to have to put some money in my trust account. And they say, well, hold on. I don't have enough for that. And I say, well, you know, I've got a wife that's out of my league. I gotta make money here. So I can't help you. I mean, I'm not always that cold. I mean, in fact, I take home way too many pro bono projects as it is. But that right doesn't seem to have the same weight as the right to stop somebody from copying. You know, you sue somebody for copyright infringement, you have got a nice big hammer in your hand, or, you know, the, let's say, a Klingon sword thing that looks really awkward to use.
I meant to look that up before the show.
Botlek or something, but you've got
yes.
attorney's fees that are more likely to be awarded to the plaintiff than to the defendant, although they are supposed to be co-equal. And you've got statutory damages of up to $150,000. And when you get I get clients that call me all the time that, oh, I got a phone call from one of these photo attorney people or one of these, enforcement mechanism companies. And they're saying that I could have to pay $150,000 if I lose. What should I do? And I think, you know, if this is fair use, why don't you have just as much of a hammer to go back? Because if I steal somebody's original work, that's not the right thing to do, and I shouldn't be doing it. But if I do that, and they have to face the specter of a ruinous amount of money only because I took their work. But what if you've taken my right, and not just my right, but by extension, the rights of everybody else to see this new free expression, which very well might be fair use? Well, I think there should be prevailing party fees and statutory damages if you infringe on somebody's fair use rights. And potentially, if you've abused your copyright, I don't see any reason why your copyright can't be canceled for abusing that. Now, that's not the same as me saying that it should go into the public domain. But since you need a copyright registration to get into federal court, I think if somebody abuses their copyright registration to go after someone for clear, fair use, well, why not give them a little bit of a reset where they have to then reapply, and that'll smack them on the nose like the bad dog, and maybe they'll do the right thing going forward.
I think that's a brilliant idea. And that is what the Lens versus Universal Ninth Circuit decision seems to be working toward, not something that specific or drastic, yeah. but just the notion that people are supposed to assess whether or not yes. there's a strong fair use argument to be made before they send that takedown notice. It's a pretty loud message by the court.
Right.
Easily applied.
Yeah, Lens was the inspiration for the article, which is and it also has that specificity in the DMCA, where if I see somebody's work that I think is infringing, I can send a DMCA notice, which will usually take it down. I challenge some of the I think some of the people who thought that the sky was falling, that are still screaming the sky is falling when the DMCA takedown procedure was published. I think they're a little bit over the top. I don't think there's a really big problem with the notice and takedown procedure, because it isn't really a notice and takedown procedure, is it? It's a notice, and you can take it down, or you can stand in the shoes of the original infringer. And I have represented clients who've gotten DMCA notices, come to me and said, I don't think this is infringing. I don't think that this is, I think this is fair use. I don't want to take it down. And I say, fine, then, you know, if you're prepared to get sued over it, and they said, yeah, sure, we are. So you can do that. In fact, I made kind of a little bit of a joke in my article at one point where I talk about people who say it's such a burdensome thing to do a counter notification, because you can do that. You get your DMCA notice. If the service provider is supposed to let you know and tell you we're going to take it down if you don't send a counter notification, you send a counter notification, and there's all these authors and law professors who say you have to go through the arduous task of a counter notification, which is like the equivalent of an email. I mean, if you can send an email, you can send a counter notification. But I say, but of course, you know, with cereal sales are actually crashing because millennials don't want to wash a bowl. So perhaps, clowns out there who can't even wash a bowl to eat cereal, I guess a counter notification is like carrying a ton of bricks up a mountain, or, you know, becoming a new incarnation of Sisyphus. But still, I think if you do abuse the DMCA, which I've seen some super creative misuse of the DMCA. In fact, I represent a website. One of the funnest clients I've ever had is they're called Pissed Consumer, and they have like it might sound, they're a consumer review website. Well, how do you get reviews down if you don't like them? Well, what one a couple of companies have done, there's two schemes that we've recently uncovered. And one, you can get a judgment that let's not talk about the first one because it's not IP. But the second one, they're using the DMCA process. But what they're doing is they take the review and then they go set up a fake website to look like a newspaper. They backdate it so that it looks like the actual consumer review was in this newspaper 2 years ago. And they say, you see, this was our column from the Barrow, Alaska Times. So that's our copyrighted material. So you have to take this down or Google has to delist it. And, you know, then you'd look in the Wayback Machine, you see that this website didn't even exist. I mean, that's really, really clear DMCA abuse. But here's the problem with how 512 and even Lens looks at this, and it says, all you have to do is consider fair use. So for all my clients to send out DMCA notices, I told them when the original Lens decision came out at the district court level, I said, I want every one of you to put a little checkbox. And here, free for everybody. If you send out DMCA notices, have a little checkbox that says, I considered fair use. You consider it. You know, you have to actually consider it. Consider it, check the box. You are allowed to be dead wrong. But why is that? Again, back to fair use being a right. I don't want to see speech suppressed when you have such a glaringly wrong call on fair use.
All right, we're going to take a break for a moment here to thank one of our sponsors. We're going to come back, and remind me, guys, I want to do these three things immediately when we come back and then go through the rest of the show. I want to answer Emory's question about, since we're having this fair use discussion, our over-under on the success of the Axanar folks. I want to talk about how... cheerleading uniforms might be like the Klingon language in a case that is now going to go before the Supreme Court. And I want to talk about another really interesting DMCA sort of loophole that a YouTuber found, and Emory highlighted that for us. So we're going to get to all that in a second. We're going to put our first MCLE passphrase into the show for those of you listening for continuing legal or other professional education credit. We put these phrases in the show in case your oversight board needs to have some sort of concrete way of knowing that you actually watched or listened. So our first phrase is going to be "Let's go crazy" in homage to Prince. And our first sponsor for this episode of This Week in Law is Tunnel Bear. Tunnel Bear is the simple privacy app that provides you with a secure and private connection to enjoy a more open internet. Tunnel Bear lets you bypass all of the annoying details that typically come with using a VPN for personal use. There's no need to mess around with port configurations, DNS, or any other router settings. Tunnel Bear handles all of that in the background. It's incredibly easy to use. Just choose a country in the app, turn Tunnel Bear on, and watch as your bear tunnels your internet connection to your new location. It's quick and easy to get started with Tunnel Bear. You'll get 500 megabytes of free data every month with no credit card required. When Tunnel Bear is turned on, your connection is secured with AES 256-bit encryption. That's the strongest encryption there is. You can bypass geo-blocking and hide your location. Your online activity is shielded from prying third parties, hackers, and other local networks. Tunnel Bear also prevents your internet service provider from monitoring all your online activity. They also have a top-rated privacy policy and do not log user activity. Tunnel to 20 different countries and use the internet as if you're in another country. Get your free Tunnel Bear now at trytunnelbear.com/twill. Tunnel Bear is the simple privacy app for mobile and desktop browsing. We want you to visit trytunnelbear.com/twill to get your free account today. It's quick and easy. Go to trytunnelbear.com/twill. Thank you so much, Tunnel Bear, for your support. That's a new sponsor for our show, and I imagine near and dear to our badass First Amendment lawyer's heart, the opportunity to have a VPN with those kinds of great functions. All right, so I'm getting back to answering Emory's questions. The over-under on whether I think Axanar is going to prevail on a fair use argument, I'd need to know more about their economics. I know they're crowdfunding this endeavor. I don't know what their commercial goals are after the fact. If it's a completely non-commercial endeavor, then that certainly comes into the calculus. But my gut tells me that fair use is not going to be their friend here.
Yeah.
Do you agree, Marc?
Yeah, you know, the odds board here in Vegas, mm-hmm. we're giving 7-1 odds at best right now.
All right, Mike?
I don't know. I might be the minority on this one. I think uh-huh. there's such a huge emphasis with recent cases that have looked at fair use and have looked at the transformative nature. That seems to be by far and away, for my money, the most important factor with courts these days. Factor number one, how transformative? Are you injecting new meaning into mm-hmm. it, or have you created a new work and really added value? Based on everything that I've heard and read about, it seems like there's a tremendous amount of additional value, new meaning that may be added into the use of the Klingon language. So it seems to me that there's maybe a more viable fair use case to be made here. The other thing I'd point out that we didn't really discuss it initially is words and phrases in and of themselves are not subject to copyright protection. It seems to me that if there's going to be an argument as to whether a language is infringed, you'd have to show that the infringer essentially incorporated the entire language and misappropriated it or copied it. And it doesn't seem like that's the situation here. It seems like what they're doing is they're using snippets from the Klingon language itself. So I could see a variety of reasons as to why wouldn't ultimately be a successful claim.
Yeah, and Marc makes that point nicely in his brief that since words aren't copyrightable, a whole language can't be.
But Mike, are you saying the whole film might count as fair use?
Well, I could see that potentially. I mean, based on what I haven't seen it. I've just read about it, of course, and my understanding, it's not completed yet. But if you're taking this particular dialect, this language, and you're using it in, you're not copying script from prior Star Trek works, but you're using it to create your own dialogue. You're doing it in such a way that you're creating a new plot, new meaning. Seems as though there's probably a pretty decent argument that that's sufficiently transformative. You're using it in a different way than how it was originally used by the quote-unquote author.
Yeah, I guess I'm philosophically in agreement with you. I mean, I believe. Oh, and look at the board; just went down to 6.5-1. So you've persuaded the smart money here a little bit. I agree with you, but I guess I'm just more pessimistic about the law, especially given where this is being tried. Right. I don't know. I'm not going to put my money on that, but this is one of those situations where you know, where my money would go is different than where my heart goes. My heart goes with your argument, but I don't think my money would go with it.
Yeah. Right. You make the good point that the Central District of California is where a lot of Hollywood cases are tried, and they're going to be, they've been known in the past anyway to be friendly to rights holders. But what we haven't mentioned so far, bears mentioning, is that the Axanar folks have really good legal counsel. If anybody can make a strong fair use argument, I'm assuming the lawyers at Winston and Strawn can. I mean, they're one of the largest global law firms there is. They're very well respected. So, you know, they have some legal horsepower on their side is the point I'm trying to make here. And we'll see, you know, so far they've done quite well with their very preliminary procedural motions to dismiss. They're definitely going after this aggressively. So we'll see where this case goes. It's going to be fascinating to watch it unfold.
Denise, yes. no question that they've got great mind property lawyers there.
Yes. Nice. You do indeed. All right, let's talk about cheerleading uniforms for a moment. Star Athletica versus Varsity Brands. This is a case that the Supreme Court has just agreed to hear, and I think it actually relates in a weird way to the Axnar arguments on the Klingon language. Tell me if you think I'm right there, Mike. You wrote this up for the TMCA blog. Because where I'm going with that is what's at issue here is whether certain elements of the cheerleading uniforms, like chevrons and stripes and things, can be separated out from the uniform themselves, have taken on a life of their own, as it were, and cannot be subject to copyright. Am I getting that right?
I think you've got it exactly right. I think the legal issue itself is, I don't know if it's as novel as Mark's case involving the Klingon language, but I think this is a copyright issue that is of very significant interest across the board and across industries. Pretty remarkable. I'm pretty certain about this, although I haven't done any hard research on it yet, that this is probably the first case involving cheerleading uniforms that's ever been heard by the U.S. Supreme Court.
I think that's probably safe to say.
Of course, it involves legal issues that are far more significant than just the litigants at issue. It deals with the whole issue of whether a useful article, whether you've got pictorial or graphic elements on that useful article, whether those can be subject to separate copyright protection. Because we know useful articles, much like processes that we talked about earlier in the Klingon segment, useful articles themselves are not subject to copyright protection. But what if you've got a combination of a useful article, i.e. a cheerleading uniform, and it's got elements with pictorial or graphical elements? Are those separate elements subject to copyright protection? So that's an issue that I think has vexed a lot of federal courts as to what's the proper test. I think the Sixth Circuit itself, when it was articulating how it was going to look at that particular legal issue, I think it cited 7 or 8 different legal tests that are being used throughout the land to assess that issue as to whether those elements on a useful article can be subject to copyright protection. So very significant issue, particularly so in light of the fact, recall a few weeks ago, the court had an opportunity to decide if it was going to weigh in on the Google Books case, ultimately didn't accept review in that case, very significant copyright decision, and actually accepted this one for review. So I think it's telling that the court looks at this as being a pretty significant issue to deal with.
All right. Anybody have any thoughts on the cheerleading case that the court has decided to take? Emory?
No, I don't have any thoughts. Nothing to contribute, unfortunately.
All right, Mark?
He's distracted because it's about cheerleaders.
No, of course.
Oh, yeah, clearly.
As we know, there we go. Yes. And guys can be cheerleaders too. I hope you guys are Modern Family fans. And
I have a uniform just like the one on Mike's article.
Yes. There we go.
Don't judge right, me.
That's from the waist down, right? T-shirt up.
We'll have to see what your lower third is looking like before we get to the end of the show. let's talk about, we were talking about the DMCA and the strained, contorted things that people do. You spotted this, Emory. I thought it was fascinating, written up at Tech Dirt. There's a game critic. Let me see. He does a show. What's it called again? I had it up and I've lost it in all of the Gym Position, yes.
Gym Position,
like,
yeah.
40 tabs open right now.
Me too.
But what he's realized is he's frustrated. He's a game critic on YouTube, and he's frustrated at getting takedowns whenever he includes footage from the various game manufacturers' games in his videos. And he's realized that some of them will routinely flag included footage. They'll get a content ID notification from YouTube, and they will routinely flag things as not monetized. And so what he's taken to doing is including footage from games that are not involved at all in his reviews, just because he knows that the content ID system will do its thing. That rights holder will get a notice and it will flag his video as not monetized. And so the other footage in there, as long as it seems like it might be a first to flag kind of issue, as long as the not monetized guy gets there first, then the rest of the footage stays in. And this is how he's getting his videos to include all the content that he wants. Am I summarizing that right, Emory?
Yeah, that sounds about right. You know, Nintendo, the only other piece of background information is that Nintendo has a very aggressive monetization requirements. So that if you are posting YouTube videos of any Nintendo game content, they want you to sign up for the whole Nintendo monetization platform. I'm not exactly aware of how the details of that are, but the results are that, yes, any YouTuber that doesn't sign on with them, that does a review of a Nintendo game, frequently gets a DMCA takedown. I just thought, you know, this is sort of segueing from the 512F discussion we were having earlier.
Right.
You know, the DMCA does give a lot of power to a letter. And with, you know, people that are saying that their work is being infringed only have to send a notice, at which places an obligation on the third-party entity or the website to take that down. So, you know, Content ID has been Google's solution to the DMCA. It's their response to the, you know, enormous number of sometimes legitimate, sometimes illegitimate DMCA takedown requests that they get every day. And Content ID is their way of automating that process. It uses their fancy schmancy audio recognition software and algorithms to try to intelligently recognize, you know, when there's infringing content. But here, what Jim did is, you know, we so rarely get an article about Content ID that doesn't involve the little YouTuber getting the shaft, that I really wanted to point this out, that this is, you know, Jim recognized a flaw in the Content ID software, so that as long as he has other game content in his video that is from a provider that is known to be okay with people streaming their content. So in this case, I think it must have been Konami and Metal Gear Solid. He interspersed Metal Gear Solid clips with the Nintendo clips as he's talking about the Nintendo game. And what happened is that when Nintendo sends their DMCA takedown, the Content ID software flags that the other part of the video is from Konami, and Konami is happy with people streaming their content. So then it becomes this sort of intra-dispute where Nintendo talks to Konami and back and forth trying to figure out whether or not it needs to be taken down. The result is that for the time being, Jim's videos stay up. Right. It doesn't seem like a permanent solution to me. Google is very good at refining Content ID. It's far from perfect, but it is getting better. You know, and I think I already read that they're trying to, you know, patch this bug out. But yeah, you know, this in the constant battle between people that are saying their work is infringed and, you know, YouTubers, this is very interesting. And, you know, to bring up what Mark was talking about earlier, giving some teeth to Section 512F may, you know, help to combat some of this problem, because the real problem is that Google is getting 60,000 requests a month. So they have to have some kind of automated system. Now, if there was, you know, statutory fees or statutory damages or attorney's fees given to people that are filing ridiculous claims, then maybe the number of those would drop down and Content ID would have an easier battle. But interesting article all around.
Yeah, and the other part of the problem is, you know, for Google to protect itself, it has to err on the side of taking things down.
Right.
And if 512F were altered in the way that Mark has suggested, it might rethink that approach.
Well, no, it might not. My idea would be more that the person sending the note, sending the notification, would have to think through it a little more, because
exactly, yeah,
you know, you've caused damage to somebody if you've taken, you know, it's just such an imbalance the way that it works now, and you know, and I think just looking at it as you've infringed on a right on either side, you've got to make a judgment call there.
Before we stop talking about copyright and move on to a few other things and wrap up the show, I wanted to check in with you about Righthaven, Mark, long from your dim past, but you were the guy who took down Righthaven.
You know what's really funny is I just got back from Switzerland, where I was meeting with the company that bought the assets of Righthaven at auction after this case. So very, very fresh in my mind because not even a week ago, I was having dinner with the current owners of what's left of Righthaven.
Right. And there's a distinction between Righthaven itself. Remind us how the assignment that was supposed to have worked but didn't was supposed to have played out. Righthaven got the copyrights of a newspaper in Las Vegas and was attempting in a very trollish way to enforce them. But what wound up happening in the case is Righthaven didn't actually have the rights and got shut down. Righthaven itself, you're saying its assets were just sold?
Well, not just sold, but sold a long time ago because we got an attorney's fees award against them that they declined to pay. So what we did is then we auctioned off some of their assets. But that was a fun little campaign. You know, the Righthaven had the Review Journal, I think, could be forgiven for being brought in on this scheme. You know, they are traditional news sources were just at that time realizing that the sun was setting on them, that the internet has made it almost impossible for the traditional newspaper to survive. And that's too bad because it's in some ways, I think in a lot of ways, really done impoverished, not just financially, but intellectually, the craft of journalism. We will look at some of the, of course, other sources have grown up to fill in the breach. I mean, like we were just talking about Tech Dirt, and I absolutely love Tech Dirt, and it does a great job of filling in that breach now. I mean, the writing in this thing, like that last article that you mentioned, I mean, just if we're talking about like fun writing, it's like beating cancer by contracting herpes and then having herpes eat the cancer or something like that. Look, I didn't go to medical school, all right? Hats off, Tim Geigner. Fantastic. I looked at that and I was like, man, that is art right there that you couldn't have gotten away with in the traditional media. Yeah. But Righthaven promised the Review Journal, I'm going to plug the hole here in your balance sheet by monetizing the infringement. The problem is they were just so damn heavy-handed about it. And there were circumstances where people were either engaged in fair use or were just really ignorant. You know, like you can, if you pirate somebody's movie, you know you're breaking the law. And somebody comes for you, maybe you ought to realize that you did wrong. But I remember one of the cases was the some old lady in Boston who wrote a blog on a web TV account from the perspective of her cat. And so every time there was a story about a cat, she would just post it and then put some silly line at the bottom of it, like meow, meow. Granted, it's infringement, but at the same time, you know, threatening somebody with thousands and thousands of dollars in attorney's fees and hundreds of thousands of dollars in statutory damages, you really had kind of a karmic infection on this thing. So where it finally fell apart was over the assignment, because Righthaven did not own the right to the work. You can't disambiguate the right to sue from the ownership. They tried to do that and then tried to fix it and then tried to patch it and then tried to amend it, but you just can't do that. You can't go out and have a futures market in the right to sue. And that's really what brought the whole scheme down.
All right. Any other updates on the case, aside from the fact that you've sold off assets to satisfy the attorney's fees award?
No, that case has been long over. You know, that's well in the past.
All right. Before we leave the topic of copyright, you know, we've been doing for many recent weeks an animal selfie of the week. I am counting down. I'm dreading the day when I'm not able to actually find an animal selfie of the week, because I don't think that there can be that many of them. But lo and behold, we have an absolute bonanza of them this week, thanks to the Field Museum in Chicago. So we'd like to present you with them, and we'd like to introduce them as follows. Yay, we have a new bumper. Thanks to Victor in the studio and Scott Carr, who created the music. So as long as I can find an animal selfie, and please, people, send me animal selfies so we can continue to use the great new bumper. What the Field Museum has done is set up a bunch of trap cameras in a remote area in the Amazon rainforest and has captured a bunch of really cool animal shots. There are tapirs and various critters running around in the forest there who are gazing into these cameras and enabling themselves to be captured. Victor, if you go to the Chicago Tribune link, the reason we talk about this in the copyright context, of course, is thanks to Naruto the Macaque and the litigation that has ensued concerning the picture that he took of himself with a camera. So we could split hairs and argue whether a motion-activated trap camera actually constitutes an animal selfie. Here we go. We're in the photo gallery, I believe. God, don't ask me to say what all these animals are. But we have...
So, yeah, the question, of course, the chat comes up with is that, you know, yes, the animal has to take the selfie or know that they're taking the selfie for it to be a selfie, right? And, of course, we do know the distinction. But, of course, it is always interesting to talk about whether or not these would qualify. I would like to see, all right, so we have a trap camera. These obviously just sort of trigger whenever the animal walks in front. I think it's clear that there's no intention there. But if we had a trap camera that maybe was tied to, like, a food bowl, so that if the animal comes up and volunteers to, like, eat food from it, it snaps a picture of it?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe? Lost school question somewhere?
Yeah. We'll continue bandying it around. Yes, if the animal knows that it's... How do you know if an animal knows that it's holding a camera and capturing its image? But yes, the Copyright Office, as we like to point out every time we discuss these, has weighed in and said, no, an animal cannot have a copyright in a photo, regardless of what PETA has to say about that. So there you go. Several animal selfies of the week for you. And I'm comfortable calling them animal selfies because the Chicago Tribune called them that. So maybe we're all just piling onto the craze. But there you go. Let us move on and talk about some privacy issues. Privacy in kind of a different context, but I wanted to bring these up because they're things that Marc has written about in his column at CNN. Jason Lai, am I saying his name correctly, or do you know Marc?
You mean the cop?
The cop. Jason Lai, Jason Lee.
Yeah, I don't know him personally, but we'll say Lai.
Lai. Has been sort of a notorious figure in San Francisco because of the texts that he has sent. People have decided that these are highly inappropriate for a police officer. I don't think that anybody could argue with that point. But what you could argue with is whether the police department has any place in censoring what he's texting. And that is what you argue over in your column, Marc. Can you kind of give us the gist of your points?
Yeah, that, you know, we're entering a world where, you know, you walk around with your phone. And this is an extension of your mind. I mean, if I get into your phone, I've got all your emails, all your texts, I've got your search history, you know, at some point, we're never going to have a technological fix for that unless you have, you know, some kind of high-level encryption that can just wipe out your phone at any moment or does it on a regular basis. But I find it really uneasy when we have mission creep. About places that we're willing to infringe on people's rights anyway. You know, my example I bring is that, you know, the TSA was instituted and all these new rules were instituted to make sure that nobody blows up a plane. And, you know, while I'm not willing to give up my liberties in exchange for making the plane, you know, 0.0003% safer, some people might be. But what have all those rules really been used to? To bust potheads who have a, you know, have a joint in their sock. You know, really the ultimate result of this has been more and more control for reasons that have nothing to do with the actual mission. Now, in this case, I guess Mr. Lai was involved in a sexual assault case. And so they were searching for that information in his phone. They didn't I don't know if they found anything about that or not. I don't know anything about that case, but I do know that they found texts that had nothing to do with that case that they decided to then broadcast. And then the police chief immediately fell over himself to say, well, there is no room for this whatsoever. This isn't allowed at all, and I'm not going to tolerate it, which was such a sharp contrast to when a cop, you know, shoots a 12-year-old kid in the back and kills them. Then you always hear from the chief of police, well, we need to get all the facts. But in this situation, no, we don't need that because Officer Lai stepped over that, you know, over that line of the absolute worst thing you can be in 2016 is somebody who says a naughty word. I find that problematic, you know, and I even hate that word problematic. I mean, I think it's, you know, and I also find the problem that we don't look to any degree of privacy in this country as being sacred. I mean, nothing at all. I think if they had found texts that had something to do with his sexual assault claim, then fine, then use those if that's what you're looking for. But you find this other pool of information. I don't really care what he's thinking on his private time. I mean, if I get into each of the three of your private text messages with your friends, your, you know, your husbands, your wives, I am sure I'm going to find something I can ruin you with, especially if I take it out of context. And we either have to decide we're just not going to communicate that way anymore. We're only going to communicate with our friends, our private thoughts, you know, in person when we're looking around and making sure that there's no microphones. You know, there was a, I forget who it was. Oh, who was the country singer that just died? Was it Merle Haggard?
Yeah.
Who said, you know, he said when he got out of jail and was on parole, he had more freedom than the average person who's never broken the law has today. He had more freedom and privacy than we do today. And that's true. You know, and nobody's really, you know, or not enough people are just throwing a red card on that. And I think it's time we do that. Now, when you do that, you're now sticking up for Jason Lai, the incredible bigot. So, you know, you must be in favor of the Ku Klux Klan and killing, you know, killing baby macaques and all that. Well, I would rather stand next to the racist Asian cop from San Francisco than stand next to the person, you know, with the nose ring and dreadlock crowd who says it's wonderful because anything to expose a racist. So,
sorry, Denise, go ahead.
Me first, then you, Emory. Is this a situation, though, where he perhaps should have known? I mean, of course, you know, you should know not to say such things in the first place. But if you are going to say such things, well, okay,
why?
Because you're a police officer, and if your police department knows that you are saying such things, they're going to fire you. But it's the if they know aspect of this that's interesting to me, right? Because your column focuses on privacy, and you should have been able to have privacy. Was this just, you know, never, if you're going to be a racist and you're a cop, you should never commit those kinds of thoughts to writing that leave a virtual paper trail that then can get you fired? You know, is that just something that maybe he should have known? How exactly did one of his friends turn him in? How did these become public?
No, they searched his phone in another investigation. But, you know, I don't see why somebody can't say these things in a private conversation. If you want to be, you know, it's like we have this indictment that you are a racist or you are not a racist. You know, you can't, why can't he be a racist? I mean, yes, because he's a cop. I don't care if he's a racist when he's a cop. I don't care if he looks at me and says, you know, this Sicilian punk, I can't stand him. It's fine. It's how he acts on the job that matters to me. Because at some point, I mean, should we drill a hole into the side of somebody's head and hook it up to their neurons? And the second you have a biased thought, a light goes off to re-education with you?
Well, you know, except that's not the thing. I mean, here when you're talking about the distinction between the response of the chief police to, you know, when a cop shoots a 12-year-old boy or when a cop says something racist. Well, the problem is that when he shoots the 12-year-old boy, the idea that there's institutionalized racism can be, you know, swept under the rug because, of course, there's context that needs to justify this. The reason why he's not saying that there's context behind here is because these text messages look like a smoking gun of institutionalized racism in the law enforcement. Like that's what, I mean, I don't think that anyone is saying that, you know, I read your article and I don't think that anyone is saying that this man is prosecuted because of the thought crimes that he had of texting these people. No one's saying that he shouldn't have the right to say these things. But what people are saying is that, all right, well, he's saying these things. He's a police officer. I think that the internet and the world at large is totally fine jumping it down his back and saying, look, this is what we've been saying all along. And to talk about, you know, the rarity of this find, you know, the reason why these text messages came up happenstance because he was arrested. There's another commenter in one of these articles that was saying, you know, what are the chances of that we have two police officers that were arrested for a crime and we happen to find these really awful racist texts on them? You know, this is what people are seeing when they see this article is that, OK, well, yeah, there is institutionalized racism. And there's a problem with racism in our law enforcement. And here we have proof of it.
Hey, look, I agree that there's racism in our law enforcement. I agree that that's something that we want to get rid of. But I find it just a real troubling situation where we've decided that this is the worst thing in the world, that somebody has these thoughts, and it doesn't matter. Any excuse for it, any excuse to violate somebody's rights in order to purge racism, I don't think is enough. You know, I don't think it's enough of a justification.
Well, what do you think happens?
Had this guy ever been accused, for example, of using excessive force on other people because of their race, that's another story. I haven't seen anything. Maybe I'm missing that piece of information, and maybe that is the case. I haven't seen anything like that. All he's having on his private phone, he's having private conversations with other people. I mean, I'm not really a big, I don't know who leaked these things. I think it was like a defense counsel in another case leaked it. Now, to take your side, though, on the other hand, you know, let's think back to part of why OJ got off is because we found, you know, Mark Furman was Mark the Incredible Racist. And does that not create some kind of a, you know, do we want to have some kind of a fruit of the racist tree doctrine where you want to make sure that there are such unbiased police that if we do find that a cop had these private racist thoughts, does that make anything that he's done suspect in an investigation? It's a theory that I bounced around a little bit with Ellie Mistal, and I find it at least worth discussing. But do we want to then? Are we then? What are we trying to do? Are we trying to create this this super race of police that have this magical ability that they never have a biased thought about anybody? Because I mean, I challenge each one of the three of you. You're not going to admit it on the camera, but don't tell me you haven't ever had a biased thought in your mind or you don't have them on a regular basis. Everybody, no matter how unracist you think you are, take one of those tests that'll show you you're absolutely wrong. You will always look at people who look differently from you. You will always look and think about them differently. That's extremely difficult to overcome just if you have a Homo sapien brain. So I mean, that's a little different than some of the off-color crap that this guy was saying, but I'm very troubled by the lack of privacy, and I'm very troubled by the fact that there are people who are celebrating this because it is their particular ox being gored. You know, the same kind of people.
Right there with you.
It's the privacy aspect that does really interest me about all this, and you know, I don't know procedurally enough about how they had access. You know, they stumbled on, what you're saying is they stumbled on this trail of text messages in the course of another investigation. And should they have been, I guess what you're saying is they should not have read them or should not have considered them. I don't know how I feel quite about that, but I do think that putting it in the context of, you know, he should be able to have private conversations that he hasn't shared. And and not face consequences for that. I'm with you on that. But the fact is, I think he was here an idiot in a way that a lot of people are idiots these days. You know, if you're going to have these terrible, not acceptable, fireable thoughts, don't commit them to writing ever, anywhere. Because if they hadn't found these texts in the course of another investigation, maybe one of his friends might have said, you know what, this isn't really appropriate for a police officer, and ratted him out.
Or they might have said, you know, the context of the situation showed that, you know, our officer was absolutely correct, because without a smoking gun, the thin blue line steps in. That's the underlying problem here.
I think that our cell phones
are extensions of our minds. You know, I'm right there with you that these are extensions of our minds, and they contain everything about us, and we should absolutely have the right to and the means to communicate securely, even though people are going to say terrible things and terrible people are going to say do terrible things with that technology. I'm right there with you on the privacy side of it. You know, I think it's I'm not, you know, cheering for the fact that this man's private communications were made public. I am more saying, cheering from my other side of my advocacy, the other people that I support, I'm saying that, well, look, for all the people that are saying that there's institutionalized racism, that there's issues with our police force that needs to be worked on, that, you know, when a 12-year-old boy is shot and the thin blue line steps in, you know, I am arguing for them on that side right now. But yeah, I can appreciate that, you know, we have to, I wish that there were stronger protections for our own private communications. Absolutely.
Yeah, that's what I would, you know, I just find it so weird that the thin blue line vanished when it was a guy making racist jokes on his text messages.
I don't think it's
right there. It's right there when some kid is face down in a pool of blood in a gutter.
Do you think that's a private?
I think it's disgusting.
I'm right there with you, but I don't think it's surprising at all, because there's nothing more clear than text messages. Having the words written out right in front of you is the most smoking gun you could have. When everyone's saying that there are, you know, I don't need to go on.
I see a direct relationship between Jason Lai and I forget her name, but they're, you know, way back in the early days of social media, one of the first people who got fired for doing something inappropriate and making it public on social media was a flight attendant who was in an airplane, took photos of herself, videos of herself, I forget, in sort of provocative poses against the seats of the airplane. She got fired. It was just an idiotic thing to do. She was showing off for her friends or whatever, doing something that she thought was funny on social media, and she got the axe. And that's just, you know, it's one of those things that I think that society has been learning over the last 10 years, is that if you joke around in a way that is durable and it's something that your employer would let you go for, you better count on it getting found and being let go. That's my take on this one. I think you just, you know, I'm concerned with you should not thought police people, but if you're going to be idiotic enough to do things that would get you fired in a concrete, durable way, don't think it's going to stay private, because it's not.
And these are police officers. You know, this is not like average Joes. These people have a responsibility and obligations to not be racist bullies, to follow the law. And
you know, I mean, who doesn't? I mean, you know, as my garbage man is out in front of my house every day. You know, I mean, maybe he doesn't. He can think anything he wants of me, but us as attorneys, do we have a right to think race? You know, the question is, do you have a right to think racist thoughts? And I think you do have a right to think racist thoughts. You have a right to think racist thoughts and say racist things. You don't have a right to take racist actions.
Well, no one's prosecuting him for this. People are just saying he's an asshole.
And he is an asshole. He's a raging asshole. We're in agreement on that. I mean, I don't want him, you know. I might have found it better if some of his racist jokes were at least funny, but they weren't even funny. you know, but he's, you know, I don't want him over at a barbecue at my house, and I don't want him hanging out with my kids.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's like if you catch somebody committing a crime because you rifled through their house without a warrant, you know, it's that fruit of the poisonous tree doctrine imported into just social life, that I would rather have everybody say, damn it, why isn't his right to privacy important? And I wish everybody thought that way, but nobody thinks that way when it's not their ox being gored. And when it's...
You're absolutely right. You know, we have another article that didn't... If you want to... All right, here's an article that I think I would be more on that side of things. We don't have it in the show notes, but let's see. A woman who was forced to provide her fingerprint to unlock her cell phone. And then
we do have that in the show notes, actually.
Right. And similarly, there was another child porn suspect jailed indefinitely for refusing to decrypt hard drives. You know, I'm right. Let's argue, you know, privacy side on that. Yes.
Well, yeah. I mean, look, it is still, I think there are ways that we can, we are going down such a dark path with regard to privacy. You know, we technologically, you can do something about it. I mean, you can encrypt the crap out of everything. And yes, you know, you can be forced to take a, you know, to open up your phone with a fingerprint, but not with a code because they can't get into your mind for that. Although there is a fun video, if you haven't seen it, of a guy who's sleeping and his girlfriend comes up and takes his finger and puts it on her on the iPhone to try to unlock it. And then she gives up and walks off, and then he wakes up and puts it on his toe. So, yeah, and then smirks, you know, at his nosy girlfriend. We have just such a lack. We have such a lack of privacy, rapidly vanishing sense of privacy. But then we just have no respect for it, you know. And when I'm on the other side of the Atlantic, it's like it actually matters. It's co-equal to your right to free speech. And I like that. At least there is, even if technologically it doesn't really get you anywhere, that there's some kind of societal and philosophical belief that privacy matters. I'm afraid that by the time we figure that out here, it's going to be way too late. And frankly, we may be figuring it out, but you know, there are, the campaign contributions do not come from privacy advocates. You know, they come from the 650 area code, which would rather just take every bit of our privacy and flush it down the toilet. So...
going back into your past, another good example of you as privacy advocate and some of the interesting things you've done in your career, Mark, are the revenge porn cases you were involved in. And Kevin Blaert in particular is anyone up. There was not just that one case. Who else did you take down?
We started with Hunter Moore. Who was like the originator of the revenge porn site. And although that was kind of a funny situation where I had a client who hired me who said, and he had no dog in the fight. He just wanted to make this stop because he was a privacy advocate. And he said, what's it going to cost to take this guy down? I said, well, I'll come up with a theory, but look, unless you got six figures to put at this, I wouldn't even get started. He said, okay, get started. Then he calls me back a half hour later and he says, well, what if we just buy the site from him and then shut it down? And I thought, wow, that, you know, kind of rubs me the wrong way because we're rewarding this guy for what he's done. But if I can get it done for cheaper than $100,000, then yeah, maybe it'll be a more efficient way to get it done. And we wound up buying the site and then, you know, within seconds of getting control of it, we shut it down. The next one was, I can't even remember. These are so long ago. We had Bully Art, and then what was the other one? Oh, Craig Britton and Chance Trahan. I love those guys. Yes. They're hilarious because that was really the funniest one because they had a website. They had a revenge porn website with an ad on it for David Blade III, takedown lawyer. And it had a guarantee that for $300, Mr. Blade could get your pictures down off the website. And I thought, well, that's weird because, you know, I remember in ethics class, they said that you can't guarantee a result. And every boss I've ever had told me never, ever do that. And every engagement letter I've ever sent out says we don't guarantee results. So I figured I'd find Mr. Blade and ask him just what he was doing. And it turned out there actually is a David Blade in the United States who is a lawyer. Needless to say, when I called him in Palm Beach, Florida, he was very confused about the situation and didn't know what I was talking about. And this David Blade on the website claimed to be licensed in New York, and there's no such person. So we figured out pretty quickly that the IP addresses and the MAC addresses for emails coming both from David Blade and from the revenge porn site were the exact same. So, you know, we called him out on it and said, look, if either David Blade is sitting next to you and switching seats with you, or you're the same guy. So that got taken down, and then eventually the FTC went after them. I guess he just agreed not to do it again, so it wasn't that bad of a penalty. Most recently, he's trying to start a competitor to Uber called Driving, which that ought to work out well. You want to get into a car with the guy who's run the revenge porn site? this Boliart and Mr. Boliart, and he actually wound up, he and his accomplice, and I don't know why his accomplice was never prosecuted, Mr. Chanson from New Jersey, but they wound up taking over, really infringing on Hunter Moore's website. See, when we bought Hunter Moore's website, we bought the intellectual property rights, including the trademark. Well, they were infringing on the trademark, so we went after them for trademark infringement to try to shut them down. Again, with this same privacy crusaders money. So that was kind of fun. And we got them shut down. And now Mr. Boliart's been prosecuted. Mr. Chanson, I guess, has gotten away with it, although we did bring a civil case against him on behalf of a couple of his victims. But yeah, we've had some good success shutting down revenge porn. It's never been, never really been a profit center at the firm, but one of those things that makes you think back that, maybe I've done some nice things in the past.
Absolutely. Congratulations. And thank you for your service to us all in taking care of those sites.
My Glenn Beck brief was better than that, but
that's right. If we had more time, and I swear now that we've lured you into the lair, we're going to have you back on the show. We're going to have to go into your Glenn Beck brief, probably not this week, but at a later time. We're going to make No One Is Up our second MCLE passphrase for this episode of This Week in Law. And we're going to get back to you with our tip and resources of the week in just a moment. But first, we're going to thank our second sponsor for this episode of This Week in Law, which is FreshBooks. Small business owners, it's time to be honest about how you feel when dealing with your day-to-day administrative work. Admit it, you can't stand it. It's a total grind. It's the worst part of what you do. You get to the end of the month, you know you need to get paid. That's why you're doing what you do. But when you sit down to try and get those invoices out, it's in general just a nightmare. It's not fun unless you are using FreshBooks. Because it is the dead simple cloud accounting software that's transforming how small business owners handle their paperwork. Using FreshBooks, you can create and send invoices that literally take about 30 seconds. There are no formulas or formatting. They're all built in. It's just perfectly crafted for you out of the box, and the invoices are perfect every time. Your clients can pay you online, which often means you end up getting paid a lot faster. And just the fact that your clients are getting the invoices from you in a digital form rather than having the traditional paper invoice go to a mailbox somewhere and sit there and have to be fetched and then sit on a desk in order for you to pay. I have found personally in my own practice, when I send out an email invoice, I get paid in a matter of a couple of weeks as opposed to a couple of months. You can get deposits with FreshBooks. There's a super handy deposit feature so you can invoice for a payment upfront when you're kicking off a project. And FreshBooks now can even show you whether or not a client has looked at the invoice that you've emailed. This is only a fraction of what FreshBooks can do for you. You owe it to yourself to feel the full effect of FreshBooks on you and your small business. Also, check out their EMV chip card enabled card reader. Getting started is simple and it's totally free for 30 days. Go to freshbooks.com/twill and don't forget to enter This Week in Law in the How Did You Hear About Us section. Start your 30-day free trial today. Thank you so much, FreshBooks, for your support of This Week in Law. Mike, before we go to our resource and tip and get on out of here, I just wanted to see if you wanted to weigh in on any of the privacy things we've been discussing.
You know, I the question dawned on me, Mark, whether you would feel differently if these racist rants were found on the phone of, say, a judge that was being investigated or maybe a legislator. Would you feel differently about that?
I operate under the assumption that every single person I encounter has some degree of racist thought in their head. So do I want a super race of judges who have no bias in them? Yes, I do. But I know I don't have that. I know every time I stand in front of a judge, that I may be on the downside of their racist thoughts. I may be on the upside of their racist thoughts. But so no, I'm not expecting mankind to change its biology. We're all divided into tribes in our mind. All right, and I do, you know, I think a good person works to try to overcome that. But I'm not going to expect that. I don't really want a judiciary or a political branch that is policed. You know, if we're going to police them of this, well, why don't we police them of every negative thought and every negative habit? You know, if we really want to go back and find, you know, what kind of leaders would we have if we have nobody with a gross edge to them somewhere? I mean, come on. You ever look up at a judge and you think, there's a very good chance that guy's wearing a leather codpiece and a garter belt under that robe. I mean, I don't know what they're doing under their robe. I don't know what they're doing behind their forehead. I know what they're doing in their written opinion and what they say in that courtroom, and that's what I'm going to judge them on. Now, if we see a pattern of a judge that it just so happens that, like, you know, wow, you look at the black defendants get sentenced to 35% more prison time than white defendants in front of this judge. I don't care if that judge was careful enough to never say a naughty thing in his emails or in his cell phone. You know, but you think back to Kaczynski having to get off of the porn case because he was forwarding memes that, Christ, you know, that's the same kind of stupid stuff that I'm sure when your grandparents figured out how to use Facebook, they were probably sending you. I know one of my grandparents was. I'm not prepared to go into that brave new world of making sure that, you know, it's not making sure we don't have racist cops or judges or politicians. It's making sure that we have people who are smart enough to when they're going to do it, it's in a closed room and they don't do it in their emails or on their phones. I don't want more sneaky racists. I just want to judge people on what they do, not what they think.
Yeah, it's a good point that you brought up, Judge Kaczynski. I had a lot of sympathy for him for what happened there. He was running a personal server that had URLs that were publicly available, and someone stumbled on the material on his server, which was meant to be very private. We're talking about a federal court judge here, a very widely respected and brilliant federal court judge.
Sure.
Who had just a ton of embarrassment because this happened. Again, you know, I don't know. It was a lack of good web hygiene that really led to his problem. And he's a very technologically sophisticated judge, too. So to have that happen is sort of sad and a good object lesson that it could happen to any of us, you know, if you're not terribly, terribly careful about keeping what you desperately need to have private as private as it could be. So it's a tough issue, and I'm glad we've had the opportunity to flesh it out on the show today. I've got a resource and tip of the week. We've got a couple of resources for you. We'll start with those. First of all, the Codex Conference is coming up at Stanford on May 20th. This is always a good one. This is the Future Law Conference. It's going to talk about things like government advancements and open data policies and how that's going to impact legal practice. It's going to talk about IBM's Watson and related machine learning tools, computational law, which would be sort of automated legal processes, which we always find fascinating on the show, overcoming barriers to legal tech adoption, e-government, legal tech in the academy, data and the criminal justice system. This is all at Stanford on May 20th. If you're in the area, definitely something to try and make. Also want to point you to a piece from Law Street Media on the rules that relate to campaigns and music use. You can find that piece and lots of other everything else basically we've discussed today if you go to tagpacker.com/user/thisweekinlaw. All our links for this show and our other shows are there. And I'm putting this one in case you are working on a campaign or just curious about campaigns and their use of music. In recent years, we've seen tons of musicians object, and most recently, the Rolling Stones objecting to Donald Trump's use of Start Me Up and other Rolling Stones songs in his campaign endeavors. If you're curious what the rules are on that, it's all set forth in this Law Street Media piece.
And that basically, in a nutshell, the campaigns can get blanket licenses from BMI and ASCAP to play music, but that has to be in the background in order for those licenses to be in effect. And artists can actually pull, at least in the BMI case, songs that they don't want used by campaigns. They can actively unlicense those songs. So if something's not being used in the background, is being used in a way that could be construed as an endorsement by the musician of the candidate, that's when the musicians get huffy about it and also have a great legal footing under the Lanham Act and other areas to complain about it. So I think we're going to continue to probably see campaigns ask forgiveness rather than permission and continue to use music in their campaigns that maybe the artists object to because music is such a powerful way to get a message across and such a powerful way to convey an image in a video kind of setting. But I don't expect the musicians to be very happy about it when they don't agree with the politics of the person involved. So much in the news these days, and you can check out the rules yourself in the piece that we've highlighted as our resource. Our tip of the week comes from something else that Marc weighed in on that has to do with parody. There is a woman out there who makes cover songs where she changes, you know, very familiar songs, Stairway to Heaven, things like this. She's called the Parody Queen.
Forgot about this.
And she calls herself a satirist. But what she's doing really is just changing the lyrics to a more religious message that she'd like to get across. So it's not technically a parody, as Marc points out. And our tip of the week is parody should be funny. And explain to us why, Marc.
Well, it doesn't necessarily have to be funny to you, but you know, there if you're parodying something, you have to be making fun of the original. So the way Weird Al would make fun of Beat It by, you know, singing Eat It, that's parody. You have to be somehow invoking the original. Now, this is simply just taking a tune and adding your new words to it to put out your message, which doesn't have anything to do with the original. Not parody. Right. But there's a lot of people who think you can just add the word parody to something and say, okay, it's parody, parody's protected, the end of the analysis. If it were that easy, IP lawyers wouldn't make any money.
All right, thanks so much for that. And thank you, all of you, so much for getting together with me today. I've had so much fun. I hope you guys have too. Oh, here we go. This is...
Oh, no. Oh, no, you're Rickrolling us in Klingon. No.
We're Rickrolling you in Klingon.
Oh, no. Oh, the humanity.
A perfect way to end the show.
Oh, the humanity.
Again, something you just can't unsee. But I'm pleased to have seen it. I hope you guys are too. I'm really, really pleased to have had the chance to have this wonderful, wide-ranging discussion today. I want to thank my two amazing co-hosts. Mike Keyes, great to see you again after our week break last week. We'll see you again next week. Is there anything you've been up to that you want to let us know about before we get out of here this afternoon?
Well, we've been staying busy at the TMCA.com, so come and join us. And, of course, I should mention I want everybody to live long and prosper.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. And, Emory, great chatting with you as well.
Thank you. Yeah, this was a great episode. I will extend that as well. And I do have to say you've got to thank Sai for that Rick roll.
Yes, thank you, Sai.
Oh, God, Sai.
Yes, he's been sending me great emails. He's been in chat with us this whole time during the show. We do appreciate it. And Marc, go ahead.
He's going to make a hell of a lawyer one day. I'll tell you that.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, a lot of people who watch our show email me that they have decided to go into technology law or communications law or advertising law because of the issues that we cover on the show and how interesting they are. Yes, of course, Emory being one of them. Lots and lots of people, I think, take this show as inspiration for, first of all, that lawyers don't all have to be completely boring jerks. I hope that we can convey that, although I will cop to boring jerkiness as much as the next guy. But also the things you can do as a lawyer matter and can be really, really interesting and intriguing. And Mark, you're just such a great example. And we didn't even get into a whole lot of your First Amendment law practice, which again, I'm going to make you come back here and talk more about that. But you really are a great example of somebody who has taken a legal career and just made it a scintillating, fascinating affair. So we're just thrilled that you've gotten to spend the time with us today and that you've explored all the things that you explore and are continuing to in your legal career and your writing. And again, is there anything that you want to leave our listeners with?
It kind of makes me feel bad when people say stuff like that, because it's you know, when you start law school, what do you do? You sit down, the pretty left of you says, I want to be a First Amendment lawyer, and then the other person sits down and says, I'm going to be an international lawyer, and they don't even know what the hell that means. And then by the third year of law school, that's been beaten out of you. And you know, fortunately, I didn't pay very much attention in law school. I was dead last in my class, so I'm very proud of that. So I missed the day when they told you it was completely impractical to have a fun and a fun legal career where you get to, you know, do international law and First Amendment law and make a living at it. Nobody gets to do this. Don't go to law school. You're not going to get this lucky. Please, if you're listening, don't listen.
You sound like Charles Barkley right now. I'm no role model. No.
No, I'm not.
All right, fine. You're not a role model, but I do think it's just great to have the chance to spend the time with you and to explore.
I'll spend all the time with you guys you want. This 2 hours has flown by, so I'd love to do it again.
It has. We'll check in with the child who was raised speaking Klingon for the first 3 years. I'd love to have some sort of study done where we find out how he or she is doing 10 years from now and what sort of impact that's had on his or her life. Just a wonderful, fascinating show, and definitely will continue to follow along with the Axanar case and find out what happens with the Klingon language. It's going to be very interesting to see. If you've joined us today live, that means you started watching at 11 o'clock Pacific time. That's when we record the show every Friday. We're thrilled if you can do that. It's fun to have a live audience. We jump into IRC and interact with Cy and all the other stuff, people in there. Always a great group in our IRC chat. So that's a great way to play along with us as we do the show. If you can't do that, don't worry. All the shows get posted. They're all at twit.tv/twill, available at your leisure. Whenever you would like to watch or listen, however you would like to watch or listen, all there available for you. Our entire archive of shows there and on YouTube, in iTunes, et cetera, whatever's going to work for you. We're just thrilled that you can join us. We hope you'll get in touch with us between the shows because that's how we decide what we're going to talk about, who our guests are, et cetera. We love to hear from you. Let us know what's on your mind, who's fascinating and interesting out there that you're paying attention to. I'm Denise at twit.tv. Emory is Emory at twit.tv. Mike is Mike at twit.tv. So please do email us all and let us know what's on your mind, what you thought, what you would have asked our guests. I always like to hear that too, so that I can try and do it better next time. We thoroughly enjoy getting together with you each week and doing this show. Do jump on our Facebook page too, or our Google Plus community, and let us know your thoughts there. You can find us on Twitter as well. All great ways to get in touch and let us know what's on your mind that you'd like us to cover in future episodes of the show. Thanks so much for joining us this week. We'll see you next week on This Week in Law. Take care.